Welcome back, friends! Recently, there's been a trend going around of evolution of so-and-so's content videos, where typically one person will take a look at another person's channel and go over how their content has evolved over the years and where they came from. And since October 8th was this channel's 14th anniversary, I figured now was as good a time as any to take a look back at my own content. We've gotten some new viewers recently, and since my backlog is massive, it might be kind of overwhelming to get a grip on what this channel is and what sorts of stuff I've made over the years. And if you're not new, if you started watching last year, or 3 years ago, or 5 years ago, or 7 years ago, or 14 years ago, it might still be nice to take a trip down memory lane with me today. And of course, nobody cares about my content nearly as much as I do, so who better than I to tell you the story? Since I'm talking about it from my own perspective, I'm obviously not here to spill any tea or expose myself. I'm honestly a pretty boring person in that regard. But I will be sharing probably a little bit too much about my own life, as I have a habit of doing. This is going to be kind of a mammoth. 14 years is a long time to cover. So sit back, relax, pop some popcorn, and get ready to learn more than you ever needed to know about Tama. In this video, I will also explain the channel's recent name change to clear up any confusion that that might be causing. So everybody dust off your iPod Nanos and put on that High School Musical soundtrack, because we are about to take a trip back to the distant year of 2006. Like any main pop girl, we're gonna break this down into eras. So this is Era 1, The Hack. I'm going to assume that a majority of people watching this video don't know a lot about what early YouTube was like, so let me sort of explain the landscape I came into. Most of what was on YouTube in 2006 was pirated Family Guy and SpongeBob clips, and a lot of pirated anime. The idea of making money for posting anything online was pretty much unheard of. Nobody was getting paid at this time to make any content on YouTube. We were all just hobbyists and bored kids with nothing better to do and a lack of parental supervision. Gaming content especially wasn't much of a thing, because the technology for capturing and sharing gameplay footage was not widely available. You couldn't walk into a Best Buy like you could today and just buy an Elgato, a device specifically designed to do that. If you were resourceful, you could record your gameplay to a tape or a DVD if you had a DVR and knew how to use it, but that was not most people. In 2006, the only way most kids knew how to make gaming videos was to point their parents' digital camera at their CRT TV screen. And if they were lucky, the refresh rate might match well enough that there would only occasionally be black bars interrupting the action. Or if you gamed on a PC, you downloaded unregistered HyperCam 2 and put up with that ugly watermark in the top corner just to show your buddies what you were doing on RuneScape. I don't have a really clear memory of this, but I think the biggest channels at the time were maybe like 100,000 subscribers, and back then getting 1 million video views meant that pretty much everyone on the entire internet had seen your video. It's a much smaller ecosystem in the beginning before the smartphone revolution really took hold in the next few years. The internet wasn't new, but it wasn't as accessible as it is these days, so in general, what was considered a lot of followers was a much smaller number back then. I believe the only other major Pokemon YouTube channel that predated my content was Maryland. According to his join date, he beat me by about a month. The most viewed Pokemon content at the time was Smosh's Pokemon theme song parody video. It was a pretty barren place for gaming and Pokemon after just a year of operation. In 2006, I was a 13-year-old in my last year of middle school. I had already cut my teeth on web surfing at the ripe old age of 9, watching Homestar Runner Flash videos and using dollmaker websites. So by 13, I was pretty savvy. I had circumvented my mom's parental controls and the whole internet was mine for the perusing. So of course, I wanted to use it to figure out how to make my own Pokemon games. The first thing any child does when they're unsupervised online. Commit piracy. The most recent Pokemon game, Pokemon Emerald, had already been out for 2 years at that point, and I was so impatient for another adventure that I was determined to fill that void myself. The only problem was, I knew absolutely nothing about game development. I didn't know any programming languages, and I had no idea what an emulator was. But my searches for hot Pokemon info led me to YouTube, thanks to Smosh, and then on to videos about bootleg Pokemon games. From here, I discovered ROM hacking. And with some perseverance and a little help from members of the ROM hacking community at the time, I figured out how to use the programs that were available from a website called Whack-a-Hack, and I began working on my own game. I created the channel that you are watching today on October 8th, 2006, for the sole purpose of uploading Gen 3 ROM hack videos to YouTube. Because I was a giant weeaboo, certain that nothing I did online would ever get back to me in real life, I used the handle that I had already been using in a few places like Cheats Guru and Neopets at the time. A fake anime-esque name. TamashiiHiroka. Tamashii is a Japanese word, and it means soul or spirit. And I chose it because my RuneScape account at the time was called moons_soul, and I was for some reason looking for new ways to elevate my cringe to a whole new level of irredeemable. My very first ROM hack videos were serious attempts at me making my own game. I'd go through all of the maps in order in Fire Red and Sapphire and Emerald and try to redesign each one. I uploaded videos of these maps as I went, and they'd each rack up hundreds of thousands of views. I think. It's actually hard to remember exactly how well they did, because every single one of these videos also featured copyright infringing weeb music, because apparently I had learned nothing from my first AMV YouTube account getting banned. Yes, I had one other account before this one, so those videos unfortunately did not survive, and I have no idea what their view counts were. I didn't have the foresight at the time to save any of them on my computer, so they're all lost and gone forever. But what I do remember is that they took a massive chunk out of my overall view count when they were removed. So I assume they did pretty well, somewhere from 20,000 to 100,000 views each. I probably made 5 or so of these videos just showing off map editing, and each of these videos would get pretty immediately popular because there just weren't that many people making ROM hack videos at the time. The problem was, I was not very good at hacking. I was still really bad at the actual process of ROM hacking. I never thought to make backups of my ROMs. And these programs let you do all kinds of things, even if there wasn't actually space for it on the ROM itself. So pretty frequently my ROMs would corrupt and I would have to start all over from scratch. So it's funny when I tell people that I used to make ROM hacks, they usually assume that I made some kind of full game that's available somewhere, and that's not the case. I never completed anything. But I was not the only ROM hacker on YouTube at the time. Indeed, there were others. Namely, Izzy Araya, who had popularized a style of ROM hack video that told a sort of a story. Like a really primitive form of machinima. They'd set up the sprites for a scene and then edit the text to be read by the player in sequence as if it was character dialogue. Izzy Araya had made a handful of these videos but then dropped off the face of the earth, so people were hungry for more. So on December 30th, 2006, I decided to try my hand at the type of video that Izzy Araya had done. The story I set up was really dumb and nonsensical, and the video itself is completely unwatchable, probably even for 2006 standards. But the fact that I titled the video Pokemon The Hack, which in my head was a play on Pokemon The Movie, made it the first result when anyone searched Pokemon Hack. It blew up in views. By 2008, it had reached 1 million views, and at the time, YouTube used to award honors for videos that had reached some kind of milestone on the site. The gaming category, which was brand new on the site at the time, was where my video had reached number 5 most viewed of all time. Since I really had nothing else worthwhile going on in my life, I decided to continue to make Pokemon The Hack videos. I created basically a whole fanfic universe of my own characters and canon, and made 3 whole seasons of this ROM hack show. None of them are really worth rewatching now. In the same way that you probably wouldn't want to watch anything someone made as a kid unless you knew them personally and wanted to make fun of them for it. But they were the best thing that I had going for me at the time. I made friends with others in the YouTube Pokemon ROM hacking community, and it became basically my entire social life throughout high school. In my real life, I attended a really academic high school that focused on college prep. And here I was with an unaccommodated learning disability just failing all of my classes. And I lost all my friends from middle school because I couldn't keep up with them academically. So I'd go to school and be lonely and bored and feel like I'd never amount to anything, but then come home and be showered with status and attention online. And I like attention. The ROM hack videos continued to do well for a while and then of course declined in viewership over time. The novelty had worn off and people kind to stop caring about Gen 3 altogether once Diamond and Pearl came out. By my senior year of high school in 2010, I had been making these videos for 4 years already, and I wasn't really as interested in the concept of making my own game anymore either, after I discovered that I just really liked making videos a lot more than I liked the process of ROM hacking. As a lonely teenager with no talents or friends in real life, the positive feedback that I got for uploading a YouTube video and seeing people comment and care about something I shared with them had overtaken my drive to make a game. Online content itself was also pretty quickly evolving. Content like the contributors to Channel Awesome and the Angry Video Game Nerd were taking off, and it became apparent that there was a lot more that you could do with media than point your digital camera at a TV screen and press record. The interest in Gen 3 hacks was fading fast, both for myself and my viewers, and it was time to try something new. And this is where Era 2 begins, the era of myths and creepypastas. Like most of my era of content creators, I grew up studying the works of the masters, the James Rolfes and Lindsay Ellises of the late aughts, so as I was reaching young adulthood, I was ready to grow into the established style of YouTube personality-driven content. Around this time, I got a copy of Pokemon Green from eBay, and I knew immediately what my first non-ROM hack video would be, busting myths and rumors about Pokemon Green. Cerebee and Bulbapedia had already existed at that point, point, don't get me wrong, but there was a lack of scrutiny on the information available from third-party sites at the time. Pokemon's own official website might as well not have existed for how useful it was. Although I was somewhat nervous about shifting away from what my audience expected of me at the time, all 10,000 of them. I also knew that the video was basically guaranteed to reach the entire YouTube Pokemon audience and immediately be a hit, because pretty much the entire YouTube Pokemon audience was already subscribed to me. On December 14th, 2010, at 17 years old, I uploaded the first video of the new Tama canon, Pokemon Green Mist video, currently the oldest video still available on this channel. Once again, I was ahead of the curve. There was still virtually no competition in the Pokemon content arena. In terms of what was popular in gaming content at the time, Gen X dominated. It was all NES all the time, as that group had just finished college and was desperately nostalgic for their childhoods. Pretty much everyone who was interested in Pokemon at the time was too young to be making content on this scale. Media conglomerates didn't care about our demographic yet because we didn't have an income to capitalize on, and we were still in such early stages of the smartphone revolution that most people were still watching YouTube from desktops. It was the perfect storm for virtually no Pokemon content to exist in this format, despite plenty of interested fans in an extremely popular series. So with an audience of hungry Pokemon fans and very little content to satisfy them, immediately, my video exploded. By today, it's racked up hundreds of thousands of views, and it got a lot of those views pretty quickly. As I was finishing high school, I continued to make these videos without competition, growing very quickly. My brand at the time sort of took on a Pokemon Mythbusters persona, debunking things like creepypasta rumors and showing off all of the things that I know about Pokemon while doing absolutely zero fact-checking of my own. In the early days, I spoke in an extremely high-pitched voice for many reasons. I always get questions about why my voice has changed now, so why not address it? The biggest reason was that the microphone that I was using at the time was a broken headset mic that I had to have basically up my nose in order for it to work. So I was trying not to exhale as I spoke, I was constantly inhaling, pushing my voice up higher, and making it more nasally. The other reason was that I was inspired by Rinri Game Game, who I thought set the standard for the aesthetic for gaming presenters on YouTube at the time. And she had a very high, almost childlike sounding voice. My voice is already pretty close to that naturally, I didn't have to try very hard to reproduce that. And I will take this moment to remind you that I was an extremely cringy person as a teenager, and that didn't magically change once I suddenly got popular on the internet. Then, over the years, as neither one of these things were really influencing my decision making anymore, I settled into kind of a retail voice for performing that's a little bit different from my lower natural speaking voice. For the majority of the time I've been on the platform, it isn't that I've been forcing a fake sounding voice on purpose. It's just that like anyone, you tend to take different tones when you're in different social situations. And I happen to take a friendlier, higher pitched inflection when I'm reading from a script kind of automatically. These days I've relaxed a lot in my approach, so the voice that you're hearing right now is much more similar to my lower natural register. But I still do use kind of unique inflections when I'm reading from a script versus when I'm talking naturally. Anyway, around this time, I made a second channel for non-Pokemon content, and this is the channel that I currently use for my stream highlights. I was worried that people would unsubscribe from me if they saw content that they weren't interested in, so I started taking viewer requests to cover other games on my side channel, so that I could make game reviews just like my hero, the angry video game nerd. And then whenever I get a request to review a Pokemon game, I'd upload that to my main channel alongside my other content. For all of 2011, I uploaded one video a month. In October, inspired by my old bias, the nostalgia tick, sorry, Lindsay, I uploaded a poorly thought out video called The Truth About Girl Gamers on my main channel. It was a well-meaning video meant to bring awareness to the fact that my demographic does indeed play video games, but because I didn't expect it to reach more than my usual audience, I wasn't especially careful or thoughtful about how stupid I sounded when I wrote it, and it went viral on R Gaming.
Seriously, you try collecting all 180 emblems in Sonic Adventure 2 Battle and then try telling me it's casual gaming.
Attracting literally a million angry Gen X dudes to my channel. This was not a very good time to be a teenage girl on the internet. I was thankfully a few years too early to end up in a wrecked feminist compilation, but it was my second video to reach a million views since Pokemon the Hack, and despite the heavy dislike ratio on the video, I for some reason found that encouraging enough to continue. Although I didn't throw my hat back into the feminist commentary ring for a while. I eventually made a follow-up to that video where I actually did research and wrote it like a formal essay, but of course it never reached the audience the original did, and since both videos are kind of insanely outdated now in regards to the issue that I'm discussing kind of being a non-issue now, They're both privated. I had grown up being told that the only way to succeed in life was to do really well in school and get into a good college, neither of which I managed to do by the time I turned 18. But during this same time, I was starting to see other dog and pony shows on the internet turn into legitimate businesses and create comfortable livelihoods. In the very early days, the YouTube Partner Program was only available to the top performing channels on the site, like Smosh or the Vlogbrothers or Jenna Marbles. Then it started to open up to anyone who applied. I graduated high school in 2011 with a low GPA and rolling admissions my only hope at getting into any college. It was the middle of the recession, and in my household of three people, all three of us were unemployed, and the two of us that were looking for work were teenagers with no experience or education, competing with 40-year-olds for entry-level cashier retail positions. Job economy was bad, is what I'm saying. I thought perhaps if I could monetize my content somehow, that might be my only way to make money using the skills that I actually had. So, I began looking for a way to do that. In 2012, I moved all of my old ROM hack videos to an archive channel, because game footage, which is what the ROM hack videos were, was strictly not monetizable according to the rules of the partner program at the time. And of course, I never had any intention of making money off of those ROM hacks to begin with. So I applied to Blistered Thumbs, Channel Awesome, the partner program, literally anywhere that I could. But my content was just too niche, too uncool, too made by a teenager, and nobody was interested despite the high numbers of views I was constantly getting. The timeline's a little fuzzy in my head. I don't exactly remember what order this all happened in, but I did end up finally getting a part-time job at my college. The job at my school, however, only lasted a few months as I was getting ready to move to Portland in the beginning of 2013. So although my content did slow down a bit for a while, it never did stop completely. And at some point, all other options exhausted, I managed to sign a contract with Machinima, one of the first gaming multi-channel networks, and was finally able to start monetizing my content. The problem was Machinima was a garbage company and my contract was for 3 years, which is something I would later come to regret. But it felt like something I had to do to survive at the time. Multi-channel networks were an extremely predatory part of the YouTube ecosystem for many, many years, but you were basically at their mercy if the YouTube Partner Program wouldn't take you for whatever reason, which was most gaming channels. But anyway, even though they basically did nothing but take my money, sit on my content, and not answer my emails for 3 years, I was finally earning about the amount that you would make at a minimum wage job, so it only made sense to stop looking for one and just go into YouTube production full time. And this brings us to Era 3, Top 10s and Trivia. This is when my channel first started really growing steadily, and this is when I first formed some sort of a business model. The common knowledge in the industry at the time was that you made a top 10 list every once in a while to drive viewers to your other main content because top 10s were very algorithm friendly. So even though I never really had a passion for top 10 lists, the strategy definitely worked. And before long, I hit 100,000 subscribers and then some. The first real video of this style that I did with this goal in mind was the top 10 fan creations video. During this time, each week I would release another top 10 or trivia video and they'd all earn hundreds of thousands, if not millions of views. This is also when the rest of Pokemon YouTube started to really take off, and Poketubers became a thing there was more than like two or three of. And a lot of these channels grew a lot more quickly than I did, but I was still doing all right for myself. But rising tides raise all ships, and it was a collaboration with one such Poketuber, the Jaywitz, that brought a lot of new traffic to my channel. I made the banned Pokemon games video for his channel, and he made an XD Gale of Darkness review for mine. And although the banned Pokemon games video wasn't on my channel, it did eventually get close to 3 million views, and it was kind of a big break for me. As a thank you, since it was my first collaboration ever, I actually sent him a postcard in the mail, since in college I learned that this is what you were supposed to do in business once you were given an opportunity. It was for the banned games video that I first wore the Pikachu hoodie, which I sort of came to be known for in the next few years. This, in combination with the launch and success of Pokemon XY on the 3DS, and a few very well-timed top 10s and tutorial videos, I began doing so well that by 2014 my videos were regularly getting millions of views each. This is obviously the era of my most prolific content output and my most growth as a channel, which makes it kind of hard to remember each individual moment because I was just doing so much stuff all the time. I had a lot of great opportunities during this time period. I got flown out to conventions where I got to meet my colleagues and have meet and greets with my viewers. I got to work with the Pokemon company themselves in a number of ways. I got to meet my idol, Genichi Masuda himself, when I went to Pokemon World Championships in 2015. And honestly, so many of these moments feel like unbelievable looking back at them, especially considering where I started. This is an era I look back on fondly, because even though it was a lot of work, I got to do a lot of great things, and I felt like I accomplished a lot. And I've never been so grateful in my life for all the support that I received. However, However, as the years went on, it sort of shifted from top 10s being an every once in a while thing to that being my main content. I ended up sort of trapped in this format that I never set out to do for a number of reasons. The competition for trivia and tutorials was getting a lot steeper. Because I was still in school, I could never be the first one to a Pokemon topic anymore, especially not with more and more people and companies jumping on the bandwagon. And I had become so efficient at making top 10 lists on a weekly basis that it was all I could manage on top of my 5-day-a-week class schedule. I had long dropped my second channel and all of my other review content in favor of algorithm-friendly facts and trivia videos, which was the only content doing well enough to justify the time that I was spending on it. And although I did grow to enjoy making the top 10 lists, it was a smidge stifling creatively to only make one kind of video for so many videos during this period of time. I wasn't doing especially well in school for all the time I was spending there, and it began to feel really pointless to be going to school for the potential that someday I might have a higher paying job, when if I were just not forced to be at school so often, I could be making more money right now. So I took a break from classes in 2015 and started uploading twice a week. I began trying to escape this niche that I felt like I was stuck in, the Pokemon Trivia Content Factory, by doing some more personality-driven videos. The Saturday video each week was a top 10, and the Wednesday video was as a challenge or a Q&A, which were popular formats at the time. I was hoping that if more people got to know me through these other videos, they'd become more interested in me as a person beyond just the topic of Pokemon, and from there that I'd be able to grow and make other types of content that people would watch. Problem was, I really wasn't doing very well mental health-wise thanks to a lot of unprocessed trauma and isolation. I didn't have the best childhood, which at this point was not very far behind me, and although YouTube began as a hobby for me, it was also sort of the only way that I was surviving at this point in my life. And it felt sort of like I was running for my life, uploading as fast as I could while all of my problems were chasing me. YouTube had become so corporate and so competitive that it was no longer the support system that it was for me when I was younger. Didn't really have anything to replace it either. After all, I was now quickly becoming an adult. My audience was largely children that I couldn't relate to beyond sharing Pokemon as an interest. I didn't have a community online or in real life anymore because I was so busy with content, and I never got any better at those social skills. So although my channel was definitely at its peak in performance, I was at my lowest physically and emotionally. And it's really hard to do personality-driven content when you already have a very low opinion of yourself. I ended up deleting most of those Wednesday videos because I had a really hard time looking at myself and seeing how much confidence I didn't have. I think at this point I didn't have a very realistic view of myself or my content, and I felt like it was a reflection of me as a person if my videos didn't do well, which was a really unhealthy mindset. There were so many factors I was totally unaware of that influenced a video's success or failure. For example, I probably should have spent a lot of that time investing in better audio, and that would have gone a lot further. But unfortunately, the message that I took from it was that people didn't like me as a person, and that the only reason my videos ever did well was because people like Pokemon. Which brings us to Era 4, Retro Game Reviews. 2015 was really the last good year for the channel in terms of growth, as when 2016 began, I started really stagnating. I felt that I had failed to escape my pigeonhole of top 10 lists, and I was watching my views slowly decline. I should mention that at this point I was in my early 20s, and I had still never really learned the back end of YouTube fully. I was flying by the seat of my pants, and up until this point it was working, but then all of a sudden it stopped working as well, and I didn't really know why. My channel had capped at about 650,000 subscribers, and I wasn't really getting any more. And my views were peaking at a few hundred thousand each, which at the time I thought was low for me. I had also utterly failed to diversify my business at this point. I had put so much time into content creation that I didn't put any of my attention into any other part of the business. I had never made a Patreon, I always felt awkward trying to sell merch because I felt like people were watching for Pokemon and not for me, and I was completely dependent on ad revenue, the most stable. I was sort of having an existential crisis. This was the first time the one thing that I thought I was actually good at wasn't working for me anymore, and I had already dropped out of school. If I failed at this, what else was there for me? Were my teachers right? And was I just a total lost cause? Obviously, I was not in a good headspace, so I did the best thing that I've ever done for myself and went to therapy. So hey, people out there, if anything I've described in this video so far sounds like you, really consider getting help. It makes a huge difference. Having another person there to help me see my life through a different perspective helped me make a ton of really good decisions. The first of which was that if my top 10 content wasn't doing so well anymore anyway, maybe this was a good opportunity to stop making content I was never that invested in and start allowing myself to grow and explore new styles and subject matters. New business models, new support systems, new audiences. Instead of worrying about making what people wanted to see, maybe I could give making what I wanted to try and foster more of an audience that likes more of the things that I like. I could escape my niche by building an audience that shared my perspective and that was interested in me as a person instead of trying to force my current kid audience to do that. After all, I began doing this as a kid and it made sense to garner an audience that was like me at that time. But now I wasn't a kid anymore and that audience didn't make sense for who I was becoming. First, I took just a few months off to focus on one really big project, the Games for Girls video. My original success had come from making content that nobody else on the platform was making, so I decided to return to that mindset. I wanted to try tackling gaming in a way that felt fresh and spoke to something that I found important. So I talked about the games that I grew up with that were made for girls from a perspective other than haha, girl games are funny. And although obviously the video didn't perform like a top 10 did, it did well enough to encourage me to continue exploring. I designed new branding, dropped the Pikachu hoodie, changed my hair color, commissioned new avatar artwork from Justin Leal that I'm still using today, and the new style that I landed on exploring was returning to my bread and butter, game reviews. I wanted to talk about more of the games that I had grown up with from my own unique perspective, since I felt like that was more what I had to offer than just being interested in a popular series. I finally made a Patreon to help fund these projects since they took much longer to make and were way less algorithm friendly, and stopped relying as heavily on ad revenue. I switched to a once a month upload schedule instead of once a week so that I could really put the time into making something that I felt proud of. Of course, getting this off the ground was tough. Building a new audience from scratch on a once a month basis is kind of a fool's errand, and the numbers reflected that. The algorithm knew that my subscribers would click on videos that had Pokemon in the data, and what I was uploading was not that at all. So it didn't show these videos to anyone for a while. But that's really okay, actually. I had a lot of fun making those videos and flexing my creative muscles after being trapped in the top 10 dungeon for so long. And those experiences in that period of time helped me approach content in a different way going forward. I had a clearer vision of who I was, what I had to offer, who I wanted my audience to be, and different business models I could explore. Then Adpocalypse hit at the end of 2016. And it added another epiphany to my series of epiphanies. I decided maybe it would be good for my overall health and happiness if YouTube was not my entire life. Maybe I didn't have to feel like this was all I had going for me if I gave myself a chance to get more life experiences, try new things. I did genuinely love YouTube, even at the low point, and I never wanted videos to be entirely out of the picture, because YouTube was a really big part of me at that point. But after being on the platform for 10 years, maybe I was just ready to grow and I needed more room to do that. It would take a lot of the pressure off in an unpredictable industry if I didn't feel like I was going to lose absolutely everything every time I tried something new and failed. I just needed a life outside my content in order to have a better relationship with it. So I did the unthinkable and I decided to go back to school, but this time on my own terms. I was not about to struggle through it alone again without accommodations for my learning disability. I was going to get the support I deserved, though I re-enrolled and I found what works best for me is taking primarily online classes. I would like to ask 13-year-old me in 2006 to imagine a future where you can even go to school on the internet. The thing was, I remembered how much it sucked to juggle full-time content creation and going to school full-time the last time I tried to do it. And school is already hard enough for me as it is without the extra pressure and distraction. So, this time to allow myself the fullest potential to succeed, I decided to treat YouTube as a hobby rather than a business, which meant taking a part-time job to take its place on the side for a while. It's when I dyed my hair back to brunette and became a full daywalker. By the way, to answer this question, this is why my branding has blue hair and I don't. Because I spent a lot of money on this artwork when I did have blue hair and then I didn't get much use out of it. And it is really good art, so here we are. And around this same time, I was finally able to escape my 3-year-long contract with Machinima and was able to join a few multi-channel networks that actually offered like support and help in terms of the SEO side of YouTube, which I was just trying to learn on my own at that point, on top of all the other millions of hats I was wearing creating content from scratch every week. And because YouTube was now my hobby instead of my job, whatever content I made was just whatever inspired me at that moment. It was this mentality, combined with the help I was finally getting in terms of metadata and SEO, that resulted in the Diamond and Pearl video not only existing, but doing better than anything I had uploaded in years. After that video, my uploads became really infrequent, but it did give me a chance to sort of slowly put what I had learned about the back end of YouTube into practice, build better infrastructure for monetizing, like designing some merch that actually made sense for me, and again, explore other styles of content creation and new topics. Without the pressure of this being the only way I could survive in life, I could finally make whatever I wanted to make. And I started to realize, as I noticed more and more people staying despite me not uploading all the time, that I started to realize that my worries about nobody being interested in me for who I was were pretty unfounded. Turns out I just have a lot of things to say and a perspective that's interesting no matter what it is I'm talking about, and that I feel like I sort of came into my own during this time. But unfortunately, I had to stick with my plan and finish my degree. So I continued to only upload every few months whenever I felt like it, which slowly turned into almost an entire year between uploads. Which brings us to Era 5. Video essays. I finally finished school in December of 2019 and got my degree. I didn't really know going into 2020 the role YouTube was going to have in my life. At the beginning of the year, I had been living most of my life outside it. I was pretty ready to just get a full-time position working for somebody else and enjoy my status as a has-been. I spent most of the beginning of the year looking for stable full-time positions that might let me continue to make content on the side as a hobby like I had been doing. During this time, I also began uploading once a month again now that I had time to, without any real intention of ever going back to full-time uploads. It was just nice having a somewhat normal life and friends that I saw every day. And as much as I love creating, I enjoyed it a lot more as a side thing than as my main gig. I made my Games of the Decade video in January, and if you listen to what I'm saying in that video, I have pretty much accepted that I was never going to do YouTube full-time ever again. Then coronavirus happened. I hesitated, but I ended up leaving my part-time job as an essential worker. And somehow, after all these years, my YouTube channel became a nice little life raft to catch me as the world began to flood for 1,000 years. All those years of isolation and learning to entertain myself and survive, living my life entirely at home, came back to comfort me in a way I never expected. Though at first it kind of felt like I was moving backwards, going back to doing YouTube after getting my degree. Once I got started again, I realized how many videos I still had in me that I never got to make and how much I still love doing this. And this time I'm doing it right, applying all that life experience I was out getting while I was away. I'm setting a schedule that allows me to take time off. I'm hiring people to help me with the business side of things so it's not all a terrifying mystery when a video underperforms. I'm smarter with the finances, I've diversified my income, and in general I just have a much better idea of what role I want this to have in my life. Somehow these last few years of not treating YouTube like a business have made me much better at running it like a business. And I'm prouder of some of the content that I've made in the last few months than I think I am of maybe anything else I've made in my entire life. While the videos that I'm uploading now are obviously not pulling the same numbers that they would have in 2015, the views that they are getting are mostly new viewers, which means that even if the majority of the videos cap at like 30,000 views, that's still a whole bunch of new viewers finding my channel and all of the bigger, meatier video essays I'm putting out, which are getting a few 100,000 views each. And the subscriber count is starting to go back up again. Miraculously, in 2020, my channel is starting to grow again. It's honestly kind of unbelievable after putting in all this work to accept the idea of living without YouTube, that just by coming back, I'm suddenly making it work again. And I have a new appreciation for it, having worked in other jobs for other people now. I think knowing that I'm not forced to do this because I have other things on my resume now makes it feel a lot more like I'm choosing to do this because I want to than that running for my life feeling that I had before. And that is a huge difference. I'm firmly finally making content that fits where I'm at in my life, and that speaks to an audience who I can relate to and that I feel like gets me. And I think the success of some of the recent content is reflecting that. The pendulum swung in two extremes. Algorithm-friendly top 10 list hell, and then really niche content that I wanted to make just for my own sake. And now it's settled somewhere in the middle, where I'm making content that I know people want to see and will play nice with the algorithm, but also allowing myself the room to take risks on weird topics every now and then. Look at my channel from the outside in. It probably looks like my content took a sharp nosedive after 2016 and never recovered. And sure, the numbers are much lower now than they used to be. But the backend stuff tells me that if I keep at it, it's going to grow, and that's something that I never expected to happen again. So here I am, back and better better than ever and uploading 3 times a month. I don't know what the future holds. I may still pursue some work outside of YouTube here and there, but I feel like I have a really good grip on things right now and I'm excited to keep going. Now, as I mentioned, I want to talk about one last thing, which is the channel name. Given that I picked the name TamashiiHiroka as a 13-year-old, it's something that has always kind of bothered me. Whether you think it's inherently problematic or not for a white person such as myself to use a Japanese pen name, I think we can at least all agree that there's a degree of cringiness to continuing to use it into my late 20s. To be clear, whenever I make any kind of accommodation or concession to any group of people, people tend to freak out about others being too sensitive, and I just want to say that no one has been unreasonable to me about this. It's just that the name, at best, is embarrassing to me, and at worst might actually be offensive to other people. So nothing is lost and everything is gained by changing it. And for the record, I am sorry if it was offensive to anyone. After all, a sort of theme of my journey on YouTube is growing up through my content over the years. And I feel like it's kind of unfair to be stuck with a name that doesn't reflect who I am today. Back when I was running for my life, the thought of changing anything about what I was doing felt like an enormous, terrifying risk. But now that I'm in a more stable place, I'd like the channel name to be something that I can say to people with more pride than some random weeb thing that I came up with when I was 13. So although the new name is still derivative, and obviously still a little cringy, I have renamed myself and the channel to Tama Hero. I'm not embarrassed of my content over the years. That much I can say at least. Most of it. Each video that I made, or at least most of them, were something that I was proud of and worked hard on at that point in my life. Even if I've made mistakes or I could do something better now, I learned something and grew from what I made, and I know that I've been part of other people's growing up too. So I don't want to erase the history of what this channel has been to me and to so many other people, but I'd also like the space to evolve with my content as we go. So I think Tama Hero is kind of a happy medium. It's a nod to where we've been and where we're going. Now, this channel and most of my social media profiles have been around for a very long time. So to keep it simple, for now I'm going to keep my URLs and my ads on social media the same, so I don't inadvertently create 14 years worth of dead links or open up those addresses for trolls to hijack. Hopefully nobody is actually bothered by the URLs anyway. But at least any new accounts and any display names on any existing accounts will become the new name. And if I could ask you to do anything, when you search for my videos, please search for it using Tama Hero from now on. And please refer to me as Tama rather than Tamashii from this point forward. So this was a lot longer than I expected it to be, but I guess that's what happens when you try to condense 14 years of life into one video. Thanks to everyone who has stuck by me over the years, and to all of the new friends who are joining us at this point in the journey. And I hope I'll see you next year for the 15th anniversary, where I plan to release a Sega Saturn game called Tama Jam, where a little Tama walks around a hub world collecting play buttons and showcasing my old videos. See ya!